1 minute to go. I have already started recording, okay? Fra 1 minuto cominciamo. Dr. Luca, I will stop sharing, then you can conduct. Very good luck for everyone.
Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to our panel 6, RippleRx Cooperation as Opportunity for Innovative Digitalization in Industry 4.0 for Manufacturing. And the subtitle of it is the case of the project SBDIO I4O in the Emilia-Romagna region. I'm very glad to be chairing this panel. And we have really, really strong speakers at the table. We have representatives of the different parts of the RippleRx. The governance, we have Professor Paolo Salomoni, which is Emilia-Romagna Counselor for School, University Research and Digital Agenda. We have several actors of the innovation system in the Emilia-Romagna region, and let us start from the academia, Professor Antonio Corradi from University of Bologna. Then we have Professor Massimo Carnevali, who is cluster manager of the cluster of the Emilia-Romagna region Innovate. And Sergio Bertolucci, who is president of the steering committee of BIREX. BIREX is the competence center of the Emilia-Romagna region for industry for I4.0. The industry. And so for the industry, we have at the table Claudio Bergamini, who is CEO of Imola Informatica and also part of the cluster Innovate as a vice president. And I will last presenting you something about the SBDIO I4O project as a good example and of the, let's say, strong cooperation that we may have in the region with all these prominent actors. Okay, so now at this point, I will leave the stage to our first speaker, who is Professor Paola Salomoni. Paola, please, room is yours.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Perfect.
Can you share your screen? Do you want me to share the presentation? What do you prefer?
If you can show the presentation.
Okay.
So I will start with some few numbers.
Yeah. Okay, here it is. Can you see it?
Okay, thank you. Okay. So I will start with some few numbers. And these numbers are related to our last Smart Specialization Strategy, S3, and this program ended, is ending, because the end is fixed for this year. So it was a program from 2014 to 2020. And these numbers show that we overcome our expectations And we got a global amount of funding that is more than 3.2 billion devoted in research and innovation actions, globally about 9,000 projects, and the co-fund was 1.5 billion. As you can see, it was supposed to be a lower result, 2.3 billion, with an higher effort, 1.6. Other numbers that can be underlined are about 60,000 people involved in education and training actions, and more than 2,000 temporary researchers in temporary positions. And we can go to the next slide. This is the past, and we are closing this program. We are in this moment providing our data to the Commission, and globally, obviously, we are more than satisfied, and we are working to the future. And this slide tried to explain what we are doing now, and what kind of future we are trying to design, and especially how we are trying to do this kind of design. We are in a very particular moment. This is not just due to the pandemic. The pandemic is clearly a very important breakpoint. But we are also near to two other different breakpoints, from one side the political point of view, and the other side is the relation between region and the Commission. So one breakpoint is the pandemic. Another one breakpoint is that the government of the region changed in the beginning of the year, more or less in the same days when we start thinking about COVID. And the third point is we are closing the program, all the ones that are open, and we are now planning to do a new to start a new relation that is also a relation affected or influenced, because it's a positive positive influence from a funding point of view, by the pandemic itself. So this slide tries to explain what we are doing. We are now working to a pact. We call it Patto per il lavoro e per il clima, which is related both to labor and to the climate change. So a global program that wants to design a new development, sustainable development for the region in the next years. It's an inclusive policy making action, and a lot of stakeholders are involved in the design of this strategy, including trade unions, chamber of commerce, the third sector organization, and clearly also research organization and university. All parties are basically committed to contribute to the effective implementation of this action plan. And we want to start from this collaboratively designed strategic plan to do strategic planning on innovation, and especially on digital innovation. So in this slide, you can see that from the PACT, two different innovation strategies arise. The most important one is clearly the new smart specialization strategy, the new S3. And another one is the Emilia-Romagna Digital Agenda. Now, two words about these two strategies. The smart specialization strategy is on the go. We need the patto to be approved to start a specific path of participation at the, and agreement. And after we have approved the S3, we need to start thinking to how to fund the development strategy. And on the right of the slide, you can see the funding plans that we are working on. Obviously, this strategy is different from the previous one. The main three elements that changed and changed the perspective of the strategy are the agenda of the United Nations for Sustainable Development that include technology and method to build a sustainable and inclusive society, the growing availability and the growing importance of big data, together with also the availability of highly qualified research centers and high performance computing facilities that are all located in the regional area. And then we have also to think about the pandemic, introducing a new concept of security for places and activity designed around the post-COVID era. And the other element that include a part on our the topic which is in focus, which is manufacturing 4.0, is the digital agenda. The new digital agenda of the region is very different from the previous ones and is shaped more on European view than on public administration Italian view. Wants to act on every citizen's life, wants to have a very strong impact on the development. It is itself based on the patto and on the S3 on the S3 strategy. So let's move on the right part, and we can see here three funding strategies. We can add all the traditional funding program, including because it's partially digital. Everything is digital, including the ones related to agriculture or whatever plan you want to consider as about a strong digital innovation part in it. But the most important three are the ones listed here. And the first one is probably the most impactful, but also the one more complex to manage and the word manage. You know, it's in this case related to the fact that it's very difficult to understand how this plan will be really how and when this plan will be really deployed. In the same time, it is like creating a queue of programs, because if the description of the recovery fund itself says that everything that is funded by the recovery cannot be funded by the other European programs. So we need first to focus on what we can and what we want to put inside the recovery plan funding. And then after this, we can start designing a plan, a funding plan related to the other traditional European funding schemes. As you can see from the slide, both the strategies and the funding all refer to an important pillar of our developing strategy, which is the manufacturing 4.0. So my last slide is how to say a light. Introduction to the manufacturing 4.0 in our new S3 strategy. As I said, the strategy is not completely public in this moment. We need to take do some last considerations after we have approved and shared the patto. And after the patto, the strategy will be public and will be discussed with all the stakeholders. The manufacturing 4.0 in this version, I can just speak about the current version, is one of the cross-sectoral thematic area. And obviously is cross-sectoral and it involves more clusters. As you probably know, clusters are organizations that support innovation action in the region. And some colleagues after me will talk about their importance and their role. There are also a large number of laboratories inside the regional network of innovation that are related to this topic. And last but absolutely not least, we have a very important organization such as Cineca or BIREX or the Big Data Foundation that have a seat that are basically based on Bologna and other areas of the region, so are clearly very important stakeholders to be involved both in the design and in the implementation phase of the strategy. In the same time, I can conclude saying that also the agenda has got a very gives a very strong emphasis to the digital transformation of the society and clearly includes in this actions also the transformation of industry. It's an innovation theme, but it's also a theme of using a regional fund to create new opportunity for innovation, both in terms of research and in terms of teaching and learning activities. So also the agenda will recall Manufacturing 4.0 as an important goal. And finally, you can cross the two documents to find the complete strategy structured in different layer. The research is more related to the S3 and the innovation, and the transformation itself is more related to the digital agenda and the digital transformation. And I think it is more or less what I want to say to start.
Thanks a lot, Paola, for your presentation. So we will have some discussion and also maybe some room for questions at the end. So now let's move to our second presenter, Professor Antonio Corradi. Antonio, if you want to share directly your screen,
sure.
You should be able to do that. Room is yours.
Can you see it? Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, good. So, as you see, Lucas already presented me, introduced me, so no problem. I'm here trying to reason a little about university and companies and trying to think how you can accelerate the possibility of going into digital transformation in a sort of innovative way. So, I'm going to sort of presenting you some reflection about those things. So we all know that when you want to change things and you want to change things in a very disruptive way, the best important point is try to make innovation the center of your context. So in general, when we speak about disruption, we have to think that you have to destroy something, overcoming barriers and trying to going the direction of new solution possible because you are changing the paradigms. And of course, you have many, many motivation, and we have seen many of those things since very long ago. So in some cases, you may want to change things because you are in need of. So you have to change because your company should grow or something like that. We had a barrier, very, very difficult. COVID was something at the worldwide level, something that really was a motivation for changing things. And of course, when you want to change things, you want to employ several techniques. They are very different. Maybe you can recur to lateral thinking. So you tend to connect things in a very innovative way, or you try to recur to any strategy for creativity. You can apply design thinking for new products. So putting things together in a different way, communicating between producer and consumers and so on. In general, What is very important, it's you need a lot of resources for doing it. So you need to invest in it. But once you define the goal, since you need to define more resources, you should pursue things only by using many, many elements, both technological and also organizational. So Paul has already spoken about big data. Of course, you should use you should be capable of using any novel technology or methodology. So it can be recurring to data, any analysis of data. You can have, if you are an IT person, you can confine, you can trust really agile strategies and things like that. So many, many technological assets you're in need of. At the same time, another important point, and that's less technical, is more organizational, is trying to enlarge the scope. That's my assumption. So if you want to change something, you should not reason on something in isolation, but you, in general, you tend to enlarge your scope. So if you are a company, a manufacturing company, you should try to understand your whole supply chain coming from suppliers, all the suppliers to customers. So maybe we can try to reason a little about the way of making your innovation something is likely to have success. So my opinion is in the sense of enlarging your perspective. So you shouldn't close yourself to one confined measure, you try to enlarge it. So the more you enlarge things, the more you are successful, or you're likely to be successful. I'm sort of presenting you some example, very, very episodic, and then I give you two example more structured. So as an example of innovation, the University of Bologna has defined with this governance a vice rector for innovation. It is very, very innovative as a role, because most universities don't have it. We have never had it. So we have decided to dedicate a vice rectorate to innovation. That's very important. The effect you can see now after 5 or 6 years. In general, we have spoken about the capacity of being in touch with your customer, even if they are potential customer, in such a way that you start involving them before they buy your products. Or I can refer to startups. When you speak about startups, normally startups are really, in a sense, trusting each other. They are not competing too much, but they are defining a common ground. And in that common ground means having common meeting, warm up, and they are not really jealous of their own market. They share it most of the time. Another thing is about organization. We have a little experience about the organization. And in general, an organization innovative is an organization in which you have a short distance between all the people inside the organization, and they share a common feeling. So in general, if you want to innovate, you have to try to pass from a sort of a competition point of view, a perspective in which you are really jealous of your customer, you don't share anything with your other possible concurrent companies or organization, from that situation very, very close to an open one in which you tend to cooperate with all the other. And in general, you can obtain a good effect if you can discuss openly about things. And the more you share the ideas, the more you're likely of creating an infrastructure. And the infrastructure is maybe the enabler capable of creating the change, the disruptive change. Okay. I don't want to convince you too much. At the same time, I have two possible examples. They're very different. I am an academic, so of course, COVID is something we have to face. You know that the University of Bologna is very large. It has 80,000 students. The last semester, we have around 10,000 courses, classes. We have 3,000 teachers, a little more. The personnel is 6,000 people. And we have 1,000, a little more, of classrooms for hosting the classes. And of course, COVID produced a lockdown, so we couldn't go in classroom. So what we decided in the first phase of lockdown, it was the first semester of this year, 2020. We decided to go online. I'm speaking about teaching. It was not only teaching. Everything should be immediately converted in online. It was really something disruptive at all, but we couldn't do it. And just to stress, the technological support was cloud. So cloud was made possible to make the change in one weekend. So in one weekend, we changed almost the thing. All the classes were online and so on. But this is not the only challenge, because we closed the first semester of 2020 and we passed into this semester, the second semester, the autumn term, and it was a second phase. At this point, the University of Bologna innovate more, because decided, differently from other university, of going hybrid. So we decided of defining new class equipment for all the 10,000 classroom. We have to, of course, try to have all the things to provide a really good teaching in the classroom for people online and also for people present. And we have to define many, many other things. And we had the task force working very, very efficiently and very fast. That's the problem, very fast, in a very small time, for having all the classroom available for September. And of course, at the same time, all our people were in smart working meanwhile. So not easy at all. And as you know, university is a public organization. We are public servants. So most of the people were forced into smart working. And it was something important, because they are changing the habits. They are really switching from a sort of a 9 to 5 or even less timing to something almost available when you're in need. Okay, so now we are almost past the second phase. The second phase is also always changing, because of DPCM, so the change that the ministry is putting out. And what is important, what is in the innovation in this sense? At this point, we had many, many resources put together. We had many skills, and we have to consolidate the change. So innovation means that when you add a problem and you overcome it, you try to understand which is the best way of using the resources. And only in that way you can consolidate the asset. So you can add it for new teaching, new trend in university affairs, and so on. So that's my first example of innovation, in which you are putting together the whole organization. And then I have something different, because as Luca was saying, I'm also involved in cluster innovation. And it's a different, completely different point of view, a completely different example. And it's the need of a local cloud, okay? We all know that we have many stakeholders worldwide providing very, very good services. We don't make names, we can say whichever, you know all the names. So they are really offering many, many services. You have a really infrastructural services available for you, and they are very available both for business and also for private user. So most of us is really recurring to all these stakeholders globally. But at the same time, there is maybe a possibility of innovating that. So why we don't do something different? Why we don't use the local context, I mean the territory, as a proactive community to produce a new offer, something very novel, not worldwide, more close and to the territory. So why we had this kind of idea? The idea comes because of the fact that most of the stakeholders are US or China based, and so companies are using their services in cloud, but they are really subjected to any kind of policy change, maybe an embargo of US versus China or something like that. In general, especially if you're a company or an organization, you have some local requirement, and you more and more tend to keep your data and your code in local repository if it's possible. And if they are local, you can have access to more flexible and maybe freely negotiable policies, speaking about possible the applied law, the properties, the IP properties, security, but also mainly trust, How can you trust something coming from somewhere in the world, not knowing the local needs? So the idea of creating a local community and the local support is very, very significant. Paolo has already spoken about that at the region level. And of course, maybe something like that we can think about. Moreover, now the new framework, Horizon Europe, is really adding some funding lines for local cloud and fog. So trying to go in that direction, instead of going toward in the direction of a global stakeholder, having something here, close, more local. So we are trying to put in together mainly two clusters. One is mechanic and the other is innovation, and maybe all the other, but also some companies, some research labs, some public organization, trying a first experiment in the idea of creating a sort of a prototype of the local cloud. That's the second example. So very, very different, coming from mainly bottom up, but as you say, people work in the direction of innovation. That's it. I can, yeah. At this point, maybe we can discuss later if you have any question about those things.
Thanks a lot, Antonio. Yeah. We move right away to the next speaker, who is Professor Massimo Carnevali. Massimo, room is yours. You should be able to... Okay, we can see your presentation. Mm-hmm. If you want to put it full screen. Perfect. Massimo, room is yours. You have to unmute, maybe.
Okay, can you hear me?
Perfect, thank you.
Okay, I'll try to give you just a quick overview of what is an innovation cluster. I'm Massimo Carnevali, I'm the cluster manager of Innovation Cluster, which is one of the seven clusters in the Emilia-Romagna region. There are six clusters that are more or less vertical or working on specific industries like green tech, agri-food, or the mechatronic clusters that was mentioned before from Professor Salomoni. And our cluster has a main goal to work on information technologies, but also on freight transport and logistics. And everything that is knowledge intensive. I mean, we are on the state of the art side of the innovation, and we try to help companies and research center to work together to make innovation something real. And we try, especially on the service innovation, to improve the value chains we are going to see in the next slides. And what is very important is that our cluster has a cross-industry, cross-cluster mission, which means that most part of our projects, of our innovation ideas, everything that we are doing is usually focused on the other clusters. As we have seen before, as Professor Corradi showed, we are involved in the project of the local cloud with the mechatronic cluster, but we also had last week an event on the ICT for agri-food with the agri-food cluster. And we have, in December, we're going to have an event with the cluster, create cluster on the use of the ICT for culture, museums, and artists. So as you see, we are really cross-industry, cross-mission, because our mission is to try to improve the innovation amount of all the other industries, mainly with ICT, of course, but also with everything that can be reduced to services for all the industries. Mainly, we work on five value chains, which is cybersecurity, IoT, intelligent IT services, which means artificial intelligence. Of course, freight transport and logistics, which is not ICT, but is something that is a cross service for all the other clusters. And big data. Maybe that sometime can you have seen these days, we are talking about Big Data Association, which is something a little different. We are more on the big data services. So innovation services applied to the big data. So no big data infrastructure, but big data services. And this is my last slide on which I will spend a couple of minutes more, and is to show that our composition of the association. Of course, we are a non-profit association as a cluster, and we are not making directly services, but we are helping in companies to make services. And our composition is more or less half divided into two great slices. You have university and labs, and I mean labs is not only research, public research, but also private research. So you have a lot of private company research labs which are inside the cluster, and which is more or less 40% of the companies in the cluster. And we have more or less the same amount of enterprises, local enterprises, mainly small, medium enterprises. We don't have the very big company. We don't have big names, multinational companies inside, because we are focused on the local environment and the local companies. And I want to focus also on the yellow part, which is education and training, because inside the cluster, we also have the third component, which is the all the training, also in this case, public and private training. So we have, of course, university, but we also have companies that sells private training services. So as you can see, maybe we as a cluster are the only table. It's a kind of a King Arthur round table. And around this round table, we have all the right people to create innovation, because we have the companies that want to innovate. We have the research, the public and the private research that wants to innovate. And we have the people that try to create the skills and the knowledge that helps innovation to grow. So as you can see in our, everything that we do can be discussed together with all the three parts of the innovation world. And so I think that this can be the boosting part of the innovation. I try to run a lot because we are a little late. So I close in 5 minutes, I hope Luca will be happy. And I give the floor to someone else, and I will stay here for questions.
Thanks a lot, Massimo, also for running, let's say. And now let's pass the ball to Sergio Bertolucci from B-Rex. Sergio, the room is yours. You can share your screen, your presentation. Perfect, we can see it. You can start.
Sorry that for a moment. Coming.
Okay, if you want just to make it full screen, perfect, we can see it.
So, good evening to everybody. I'm be talking about this B-Rex. B-Rex is a competence center. It was an initiative launched by the Ministry of Economic Development a couple of years ago. It was constituted in 2018. It is a public-private consortium which was given on a competitive basis. 8 of these competence centers have been formed, and Bologna is adding one of them. It's a big constituency in itself because it sees 57 big players. It has it is not only a network, it has a physical place where it stays and where it acts as a center of innovation, which I will shortly describe. The partners are 28 end user companies, 12 institutions, out of which 5 university, then research institutes and companies or foundation which are connected to innovation, and 17 provider companies. You see a sketch of them here, but what is important is these companies have a big impact on the territory because they employ 300,000 people. They have an aggregate turnover of 100 billion and more. And they have a lot of impact in technology transfer projects and in patents. At the same time, the supporting public institution have also a large impact on the knowledge creation because they encompass a large number of research fellows with a lot of production in intellectual property. And on top of that, we are concentrated on big data also because we are living in a place which contains, for a number of historical reasons, more than 90% of the computing power in Italy. So our partners are, you can see the composition here, and you can see different things. For instance, we are 60% dominated by big companies, but with a reasonable representative of small and medium enterprise. We are 60% Emilia-Romagna, but we have extension outside the region, and the industry sectors are covering a very large part, with a big part which is covered by mechatronics and ICT. So the whole idea behind this competence center is just to build a sort of nuclei which can connect different partners. And as you've seen, in this region, there are a lot of lively and very established partners. So we would like just to have the ambition just to be another place where to aggregate and where just to make use cases and possibly success cases on this very long and not linear path to evangelization. You know, digital transformation is the number of many, many things. And we are willing just to explore some of this corner, not only in the region, but with the ambition, of course, not only just to connect with our fellow competence centers, but also just to connect outside the region, in Italy and in Europe at large. We have essentially structured our competence center around a pilot plant, which I will then briefly describe, in order that we can do use it as an attraction point for things that we are doing in-house. Whereas we are also at the same time launching projects, innovation projects, which happens also elsewhere inside the region and in different buildings. And all these components, we are somehow harmonizing them in such a way that we constitute more and more an attraction point where real projects, real vertical projects can be done. One very important tool is just that we have defined and we have refined what was written in our early proposal through a number of workshops which have been used just to define in with more precision the teams out of which we would launch competitive calls. And the teams are covering most of the tools that are needed in the digital transformation for Industry 4.0. At the same time, they were made vertical enough, but still broad enough just to attract more and more sectors. So we launched these calls. The competence center was formed with the contribution of the ministry of about 9.2 million euros, which were backed up by 14.4 million put in by the partners and with a horizon of 3 years. It was a 3-year project. And we are using most of this money just to do these competitive calls. And the other part has been used mostly for setting up this pilot line. We have done already two rounds of calls. The first one was endowed by 3.2 million. And you can see that the topics which we have explored and the project that we gave out, we are already done with the second call, and we are preparing the third and last call where our budget will be exhausted for the time being. All these projects, also the novelty of these projects, all the started projects, are being peer reviewed in such a way that we can create inside this community this sentiment of open innovation, which is very important, as was said by the previous partner. And this is proving just to be very effective, just to have the project keep on their goals and just avoiding useless duplication or helping them somehow surpass some difficulties that might arise. On top of that, the end product, the deliverable of this project, are products which should have a technical readiness level 7 up, 7, 8, in such a way that they could be success stories just to be used to a wider community. The principle of the calls in which we have selected them are informed to these topics I say, and of course they are also very look at the sustainability, which we believe is a very, very important topic. The pilot plans is another very important asset of the competence center, because it integrates in a single place all the components of the industry of the future in a way which is flexible, you can reconfigure it, and which is open, in such a way that is a place where you can do not only hands-on training, but also real small production, test some ideas that you have, and produce product with innovative ways or innovative products which might have high added value. It contains all the goodies that you would like just to have inside the factory of the future. But on top of that, it contains a very robust and very high quality and high performance way of connecting all the data and connecting it through edge computing to the wider cloud. So it's a perfect place where you can test hands-on prototypes of any model of new production. This will be open to all the partners, and not only to the partners, will be open to all the actors which are very active in this region. And we have just inaugurated it. The line is being commissioned now, will be fully operational within the end of the year. Finally, in summary, what I'm very proud just to say is that we are up and running. We are, we believe, a unique and powerful asset, very well integrated in a very lively environment, as you have seen. We are executing solid, a medium-term project with a long-term vision, because we want just to, we are here now, but we our ambition is just to stay here well beyond the end of this program of the ministry. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sergio, for your point of view. And now let's move to the industry. So let us remind, we are in the Triple Helix. So we had the governance, we had various actors in the innovation, and now industry with Claudio Bergamini. Claudio, please, room is yours.
Hi, nice to meet you. So, pass to the industry. I'm the chairman, the founder of a consulting company. Our consulting is not typical because it deals around IT architecture, mainly in the financial market. So banks, insurances, fintech, and the financial market in the last 10 years at least had a great announcement of technology involved. They are experimenting, they experimented in the last years the growth of volumes, the need of a new infrastructure, the experimentation of artificial intelligence, big data, and whatever now is coming at the horizon of the manufacturing industry. In our consulting, we are required to select new technologies and apply them in critical markets. We are not slide consultants, but we make also delivery. So the need to touch with our hands the new technologies, experiment and propose them to the customers. So we need innovation. We live of continuous and open innovation, and this is the reason and the way I'm explaining why we are a member of the Innovate Cluster, that is one of the member of the Emilia-Romagna region ecosystem. Of course, due to the business we daily make, we have partnership from universities since dozens of years all over Europe. And we recruit talents from these universities. But some years ago, we realized that we were losing something, that was the contact with the local ecosystem. So the cluster Innovate that Professor Carnevale explained some minutes ago is one of the most valuable places we have locally to be able to grow daily and stay continuously inside the regional ecosystem of innovation. The innovation cluster matches perfectly our characteristics. It fits in our company culture because as a consulting company, we live recruiting young students and helping them grow, learn continuously. And we need in the company a culture of continuous innovation, first of all, and continuous collaboration. And the cluster is an aggregation of research centers, universities, and other companies that are, most of the cases, are also potentially our competitors, but in our opinion, it's better to collaborate, also if sometimes it's needed to compete. So we belong to the Innovate cluster since 2 years from the beginning. And I want to explain you some of the outcomes of this collaboration. We explored since more than 10 years ago a characteristic that is the internal incubator. the world was not yet created, but we acted like an incubator with the internals idea. Today, this is the participations that we have. Six of them are internal spin-off. So one consultant arrives with an idea. We work on the idea. We help him check the idea, build a business plan. And if at the end the reasons to create a new company comes out from this audit, we help the person to create a new company. So belonging to the cluster Innovate helped us to find one potential collaboration, and 6 months later a new company was born coming from another member of the cluster Innovate and Imol Informatica and some other, and the company is AgroAdvisor. AgroAdvisor, it's a agri-tech company working on satellite analyzement of informations and belonging to the value chain of agricultural products transformation, using innovation innovative technologies like artificial intelligence and blockchain to notarize all the information of the supply chain. The company was founded 1 year ago and is now realizing the platform that is the base, that will be the base of the offering of this company. From the collaboration with one university and research center was born Cyberloop, another startup 6 months ago. And we are working on a B-Rex project dealing with architecture for IoT inside the mechanical manufacturing. So at the moment, we collected from the membership of the Innovate cluster all the goals that we have when we decided to subscribe it. So my time is finished. Thank you very much.
I'm here. Thanks a lot, Claudio, for your presentation. And now we still have some minutes. I will go on with my presentation. And let's see if we still have some. I will try to go fast to have some room for discussion, but I prefer to leave some few more minutes to all the presenters, because these presentations were really very, very interesting, I think, for the whole audience, giving different points of view. So now going to my presentation, I'm the principal investigator of this project, which is about big data services for Industry 4.0. Big data services in and out, meaning inside the manufacturing industry, in the shop floor, basically, or outside it. So that is also why we have as a kind of subtitle from shop floor to after sale for the project. SBDIO I4O is, for me, a good example of the Triple Helix cooperation. In fact, it comes and is funded from EU funds going through the region for the regional development. And the governance here played a key role, because it was an open call in the previous SS3 professor strategic plan, and that was really a good way of financing such initiatives for innovation. Then it required a direct involvement of the academia and research institution through what we have in the Emilia-Romagna region, which is the so-called Emilia-Romagna region high technology network, which include laboratories which are both linked with the university or private ones. And the last important stakeholder is the industry, of course. And so participation of companies, and most important in this area, which is the manufacturing and I4.0, the participation of different kinds of companies. So both from the IT sector, but also from the manufacturing sector. And by the way, Imola Informatica is part of our partnership in this project. And what is the main goal of SBDIO I4O? It is to facilitate the local manufacturing enterprises in the transition from a product to a service economy. So basically, nowadays, most of the producers or some years back actually were mostly selling products. But the shift that we had in other consumer products, now we have the same kind of shifts towards selling services also in the manufacturing sector. So a producer who is producing an automation machine is not more only selling the automation machine, but also some services like after sales services and so on and so forth. So I want just to stress a few points here. The first point is that the partnership is quite rich and widely integrated, and it includes both labs, as I was anticipating, which are part of the excellence network of research, but are of two different kinds: IT labs, so labs that are more focused on IT aspects, and also a lab which is about mechanical and automation topics, which is the CIRIMAM, CIRIMAM. And at the same time, the partnership includes several companies. Companies that are both IT companies and non-IT companies. And that's crucial in this area, because only by bringing up some conversation between these very different realities that work on the research, on the one hand, and on the production on the other hand, but also on the IT per se, and on the manufacturing, it is possible to truly address the big challenges in order to move toward servitization and to move from a product economy to a service economy. And so we are there in the middle of it, as the SBD IO I4O project, trying to bring together all these different competencies. And of course, these are the core competencies, but then our, let's say, aim is also to bring together, of course, the people that can make it possible. And focusing more on the technical part, just to give you some examples of what we are doing, I want to link a bit to what has been previously said. We have a strong idea of trying to build a local federated environment, basically a federated local cloud environment for the manufacturing sector. And so the idea is to have a unique federated cloud platform that can be used by all the main manufacturers in the region. So in this project, of course, we are developing a small prototype, but the medium long-term goal would be to provide it as a pilot of something that can be enlarged and scaled up. In the sense of providing common functionalities, common features, and of course, computing power and so on and so forth, to all those companies that that are in need for it. And indeed, that includes functionalities that nowadays are more and more used in this sector, like, of course, AI, machine learning, and so on and so forth, but also to have some specific verticals, specialized verticals for some of the needs that our manufacturer demonstrate and have. And for instance, within the shop floor, of course, such services include the monitoring and control and data gathering, the predictive maintenance, the troubleshooting, and so on and so forth. As for the out services, the after sale, for instance, services instead, here, what we are trying to put together is something that derived from a request from our manufacturers to develop some kind of mashups from the data flows that they already do have available inside the company and those ones that are available outside, for instance, in social networks, services, and so on and so forth. And so from this mashup, it can indeed help to develop some new added value innovative services. For instance, we have a producer of ice cream machines, which is Carpigiani, and they would like to cross some of the data that they already do have from the monitoring of their machines that are deployed all around the world, to cross these data with the data that might come from social networks like Facebook and so on and so forth. For instance, to give an additional added value service to their customers to help them to decide where to open a new shop, a new ice cream shop and stuff like that. Okay, just to give you a rough example of what can be a service out for SBDIO I4. Okay, that concludes my short talk. And now, indeed, we still have a few minutes, very few minutes, for some discussion. If I may, as I am the chairman, I will start with just one question to close the loop with the first speaker, with Paola. And if it's possible, Paola, to give us some more information about the Data Valley Bene Comune initiative, which was bringing my attention to that initiative, if it is possible.
Yes, of course. And this is the what we call digital agenda of the region. It is regulated by a specific law, and we have to pass it through the government of the region and then the assembly of the region. And usually it was thought as a set of actions limited to the public administration and its transition to some digital services or whatever. So it was more or less an action from the regional government to itself or to the local public administration of the region. Now we designed it starting from the government program and from the patto and from the S3. So this is a very different program and it includes all the digital actions related to all the kind of activity that a regional entity can do from complex activity related to research, real research, or innovation program. But we can find innovation also in agricultural program, for example. You can find a lot of digital issues and digital related stuff in the program of the Minister of Agriculture of the region related to precision agriculture, for example. So we are trying to put everything together because we think that we need a strong ICT industry and a strong innovation system is a sort of stack. You know, you have the citizen and the agriculture at the bottom, but you need to have a strong ICT industry and a strong research and innovation to provide solutions that are, local to the regional system. So our idea is to write it, putting all together and trying to do all the possible crossings between the different level where technologies arise from research to day by day. And that's the new approach, I think. It has been designed with a very large community, including, for example, university, but including also all the partners of the Aster network. So I think everybody was involved somehow in writing or reading it. But we are also starting another, sharing a moment just to be sure that everybody can contribute to write this agenda. It tried to design the digital region 5 years from now.
Thanks a lot. Now, as time has really passed away very fast, let me take again the opportunity to thank all our speakers, maybe also to virtually having this clap of hands from me at least, and I'm sure it is also the same for all our attendees. So thank you a lot again. Sorry for not having a wider discussion with all of you, and thank you very much for attending and for delivering your presentations and for your time. Hope all the audience liked our panel, and let us continue the conference. And I also remind all the panelists and the speakers that we have the platform where we can continue also contributing and having some discussions with all the attendees. Okay, thank you again.